طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا وقائدنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله الطيبين وأصحابه الغر الميامين أفضل الصلاة والسلام. سلام من الله عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. After praising Allah جل وعلا and sending salutations upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we proceed. Our topic today that we'll be discussing inshaAllah ta'ala, it is the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf, the story of the people of the cave. Right. Now before I get into it, I want to know, what do you guys know about the people of the cave? Huh? What do you guys know about them, their story? What have you heard about them?
They believe in God.
They believe in Allah, sahih. Uh-huh. What else? What's their story? Huh? What do we know about them? Anyone have any idea? Of who they are? What happened to them? What did they do?
Were they getting chased for their religious beliefs and then they had to flee into the cave?
Sahih. Uh-huh. Correct. You're right. They feared for their... A bit louder. Wait. Yes, they fled their people in order to safeguard their deen. Sahih. What else?
They were young.
They were young men. How many were they?
3 or 5 or 6.
Sorry?
The number is not definite. How many young ones?
And they had a dog with them.
Yeah. I mean,
Sahih. What else? What else do you know about them? Is that it? طيب, yes?
Stayed in the cave for 309 years.
309 years, correct. Did they just stay there? What were they doing?
They slept.
Uh-huh. 309 years they slept in the cave, right? So they are a sign from the signs of Allah. Huh? Allah Azza wa Jalla allowed them to sleep for 309 years in the cave. Okay? And where was the cave located in terms of where it located in terms of the sun?
Directly on the sun, opposite the sun.
Eh, sahih. So they were getting sunlight. Sah? They were getting sunlight as well. To keep them alive. Huh? طيب. Allah Azza wa Jalla in Surah Al-Kahf, at the beginning of the surah, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he mentioned the story of the young men of the Kahf. These young men, one day they saw their people, they had an Eid, they had a celebration. And they saw that they were glorifying their idols and prostrating to them. And they felt in their hearts that this was not right. Allah Azza wa Jalla inspired them with Iman, that this is not right. But we have to worship one Lord, Allah Jalla fi'ala. So what do? They left this. Okay, they were young men. And they didn't worship these idols. And they didn't glorify them. But rather they worshipped Allah Azza wa Jalla. And they said, رَبُّنَا رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَن نَدْعُوَ مِن دُونِهِ إِلَهَا لَقَدْ قُلْنَا إِذًا شَطَطًا. So our Lord, it's the Lord of the heavens and the earth. لَن نَدْعُوَ مِن دُونِهِ إِلَهًا. We are not going to call on any other God except Him. If we do so, لَقَدْ قُلْنَا إِذًا شَطَطًا. Whatever we do is false. That's what they said. Okay? And this shows the importance of the matter of Tawheed. Okay? That's the reason why Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala created us. Right? Why are we here in the dunya? Why are we here in the dunya? What's the reason why we're here? To worship Allah, right? What's the evidence for that from the Quran? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah says, I have not created jinnkind and mankind except to worship me. So the reason why we're here is to worship Allah Jalla wa Ala. These young men, they realize that. They're here to worship Allah alone, right? So our goal in life, it is to try to make every aspect of our life ibadah, worship. Now the question that arises now, it is, what is worship? What's ibadah? The reason why I'm asking you questions is to make sure you guys stay awake, because I heard you guys haven't slept last night. I heard you guys got up to crazy things. With the cars. Huh? With the boot open. So we have to make sure you guys are awake. Tayyib, what's ibadah? You guys driving the cars with the boots open, is that an act of worship? Tayyib, ibadah, who can find ibadah for me? Worship. We have an answer, listen. You have an answer. What's ibadah?
You can turn all your acts into worship.
Okay, what's the definition? I want the definition of worship. What is worship, Yani?
Obey. An action that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
An action that pleases Allah, yes, that's part of it. Elaborate more. What else? Yes?
Because we're obedient, so instead of an act that represents our obedience to Allah
subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am, that shows your servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, correct. More than that, I want a very specific definition. What's your name?
Khalid.
Khalid mentioned some of it, of the definition. But there's more to it than that. He said, an act that pleases Allah. And what else? Yes?
And that's done according to the conditions.
According to the conditions, correct. In order for it to be accepted. Yes. What else? Yes? Nah, you're doing it solely for Allah, correct. That you're sincere in that act, and that's a condition of worship. However, the definition of worship, it is a comprehensive term, worship, for everything Allah loves and is pleased with, okay? In terms of speech and actions that are apparent and hidden. That's the definition of worship. Now, when we define worship as that, ibadah, when you define it as that, okay, many things can become acts of worship. Even the car stuff. it can become an act of worship. How? The intention. Right? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, let's use the car thing as an example. Your shenanigans. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says in a hadith, أَحَبُّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ سُرُورٌ تُدْخِلُهُ عَلَى قَلْبِ مُسْلِمٍ. He says that the most beloved deed to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, it is happiness that you place in the heart of a Muslim. Okay, if that makes you guys happy, even though it's dangerous, it could be an act of worship. The Prophet Ali is also in his time, there was some Sahaba, or there was a specific Sahabi, who would perform, he would do practical jokes, okay? And the only reason why he did it was to make the Prophet Ali laugh. Okay. So what happened? I'll mention one of the incidents, what he did. His name was Nu'iman. What he did was, he fell out to one of the Sahaba. Okay. So he wanted to prank him or do something to him. So what he did was, he saw some guys in the market and he said to them, listen, I have a slave. And my slave, I want to sell him. Okay. So I'll sell him to you for this price. But I'm going to inform you that he rebels a lot. And he tends to say that I'm not a slave. So ignore that. Okay. So they said, okay. They gave him the money. And they said, okay, there's a slave, go take him. So they went to him, they grabbed him. And he said, what are you guys doing? We bought you a slave. He said, I'm not a slave. They said, yeah, he told us you say that. And they took him. Right? They took him away. And the Prophet alayhi salatu was informed about this. And the Prophet alayhi salatu laughed until his molar teeth could be seen. Right? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then what did he do? The Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he went to those people and he paid from his own pocket the money, their money back, and he freed the Sahabi. Right? And he went looking for Nu'ayman, he saw Nu'ayman hiding in bushes, and then he laughed at him and told him, come out. Subhanallah. Another incident, what he did was he he was very hungry. He was from the poor Sahaba, so he wasn't very rich. So one day he was very hungry, and he wanted to eat something. So what he did was, he told the Sahabi, "Let me look after your camel for you." Okay. So he entrusted him with his camel. What did he do? Slaughtered it. And then he took the meat to the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba, they sit there. He went to the Prophet, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, this is a gift from me to you." The Prophet ﷺ says, he knows that Ayman can't afford all this. So he's doubting him. He says, "Okay, the Prophet ﷺ says, just accept gifts." And he ate it. And then a man came, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, this man, he slaughtered my camel. And then Nu'ayman ran away. And the Prophet alayhi sallam, he started laughing. And then he paid for the camel again. He's paying for Nu'ayman's practical jokes. And he laughed and he said, "Nu'ayman, you're making us poor." Sallallahu alayhi sallam. So, but Nu'ayman radiallahu anhu, he was someone who would make the Prophet alayhi sallam laugh in his lifetime. But after the Prophet alayhi sallam passed away, he never laughed again. He never laughed again. Indicating that the only reason he did it was to make the Prophet alayhi salam laugh. Right? Nah. And obviously everything he did, he never did anything haram, by the way. If you're going to joke, you have to joke within halal boundaries. You can't lie to joke. The Prophet alayhi salam even joked. Right? An old woman came to the Prophet alayhi salam and she said, "Ya Rasulullah, wala anta jannah?" He said to her, "No, old women don't enter Jannah." She walked away crying. And they said, come back. And he said, because everyone will be 3 years old in Jannah. That's why. So it was a joke. He told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he never lied when he joked, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? So as long as you joke in the boundaries of halal, it's okay. If it makes someone smile, someone laugh. But ibadah here, okay, it is everything that Allah Azza wa Jalla is pleased with and loves. So that means Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala legislated it. It is permissible. Because if it's not legislated, Allah does not love it and is not pleased with it. Okay? In terms of speech and actions, okay? What are apparent and hidden? What do you mean by hidden? Between you and Allah, but more than that. By hidden, what do you mean? We mean the actions of the heart. Who knows if you're sincere or not? Only Allah, right? It's an act of worship of the heart. Humility is in the heart. Fear is in the heart. Love is in the heart. Hope is in the heart. These are all acts of worship that are in the heart. Right? So these are hidden acts of worship. That's ibadah. And ibadah has two conditions. In order for Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to accept your act of worship, what are they? What are the two conditions? What's the first one? The intention, yes, sincerity, that you're sincere. If you're not doing it for Allah Azza wa Jalla solely, then Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala will not accept it. It will be rejected. That's number one. And number two? Na'am, it's in accordance to you're following the guidance of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Right, that it is legislated in the Sharia. With those two conditions, and with the definition of ibadah meant, okay, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala will accept your worship. That's ibadah. That's what Allah created us here for. Right. So these young men, okay, they understood that, and they realized that them being in that environment with their people will not allow them to do so, to worship Allah. And so they fled, and they went to a cave. And when they went inside the cave, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا. Allah says, فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ. What does that mean? It means Allah made them go to sleep. But the expression here used in the ayah, okay, ضَرَبَ in Arabic language, it means hit, he hit. Okay? عَلَىٰ on. آذَانِهِمْ there. Is okay, يعني Allah Azza wa Jalla stopped them from hearing when they're sleeping, because normally when you're asleep you can hear, right? Unless you're a really deep sleeper. You can generally hear what's going on, right? Like last night. Huh? Some people woke up 3 a.m. looks at you guys. What are these people doing? But you, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala stopped them from hearing, so they don't wake up. Okay? فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ عَذَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا. Years, 309 years, sleeping. آيَةٌ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ. Okay? And then Allah Azza wa Jal, after those 309 years, and He protected them in that kahf. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, woke them up. After their deep sleep, all those years. Right? And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala would turn them on their left, on their right while they're sleeping, so that the earth does not consume their bodies. They stay alive then. They're preserved. Right? And it's all from the rahmah of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala bi ibadi. Because they took a step towards Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and they intended to protect their deen, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala completely protect them from the fitna that was outside with their people of shirk, because nothing's worse than shirk. Associating partners with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, everything that leads to it. Because they ran away from that fitna, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala protect them completely from that fitna. And not only that, but Allah Azza wa Jal made them a sign for those who came after them. And not only that, but Allah tabarak wa ta'ala told us their story so that we take lessons from it. They mentioned إِلَىٰ قِيَامِ السَّاعَةِ until يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, indicating that whoever is attached to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and he takes a step towards Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala runs towards him. As we have in Hadith Qudsi. In Hadith Qudsi, Allah Jalla wa ala, he says, as the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he says, that if my slave, he comes to me walking, Allah comes towards him, running. If you go towards Allah Azza wa Jal, a hand span, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala can come close to you, an arm span. You just take that initial step. And that's where Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا. Those who strive for our sake, Allah says, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. We will definitely guide them to our paths. Allah will open doors for your paths. And then Allah says, وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is with those who do good. So that's the requirement, that you strive for Allah's sake. Do what you can, your ability. And Allah Azza wa Jalla make the rest easy. Definitely Allah make it. Allah emphasizes twice in the ayah. The lam, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ is lam of tawkeed. It's for emphasis. The noon at the end of the word is for emphasis. It's called noon of tawkeed. Indicates that definitely 100% without any doubt Allah Azza wa Jalla will guide you to His paths. And then Allah emphasizes again, وَإِنَّا, and verily, emphasis, tawkeed. Allah, la, lam of tawkeed again, la ma'al muhsin. Allah is, verily Allah is with those who do good. You do good, ihsan, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will be with you, ma'iyatullah. And if Allah is with you, what else do you need? And that's why the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he nurtured the Sahaba upon that. Even when they were young. As we have in the famous hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. Abdullah ibn Abbas, when the Prophet alayhi salatu salam passed away, he was 13 years old. Very young. So when he's a lot younger than that, the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he was on a riding beast with the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. He says, كُنْتُ خَلْفَ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He says, behind the Prophet alayhi salatu salam on his riding beast. And then the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he says to him, يَا غُلَاب, O young boy, إِنِّي أُعَلِّمُ كَلِمَاتِ. I'm going to teach you some words. He says to him, إِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ يَحْفَظْكَ. إِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ تَجِدْهُ تِجَاهَكَ. إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهَ. وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. وَعَلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةَ لَوْ اجْتَمَعَتْ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعُوكَ بِشَيْءٍ لَمْ يَنْفَعُوكَ بِشَيْءٍ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ لَكَ. وَلَوْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ بِشَيْءٍ لَمْ يَضُرُّوكَ بِشَيْءٍ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ. رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف. He says, Ya Ghulam, I'm going to teach you some statements. احفظ الله, be mindful of Allah, and Allah will protect you. احفظ الله تجيث الجاه, be mindful of Allah, you find Allah in front of you, with you, wherever you are. إذا سألت, if you ask, فاسأل الله, ask Allah alone. وإذا استعنت, and if you seek assistance, فاستعن بالله, seek assistance from Allah. وعلم, know, أن الأمة, if all of the ummah, all of mankind, they came together to benefit you with something, they will not be able to do so except with what that Allah Azza wa Jalla has decreed for you. And if they all came together to harm you, they will not be able to do so except with that Allah Azza wa Jalla has written against you. رفعت الأقلام, the pens have been lifted, huh? وجفت الصحف, and the scrolls have dried. قدر. To be content with Allah Azza wa Jalla, Allah has decreed for you. Right? And the other narration, the riwayah, says, احفظ الله تجث أمامك. تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة. Be mindful of Allah, you find Allah with you, in front of you. Remember Allah Azza wa Jalla in times of ease, Allah will remember you in times of hardship. So this is the individual, that's what the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he taught the Sahaba. And because the Sahaba, they were taught this and they were nurtured upon this, they became great. And the Sahaba, majority of the Sahaba were young. Majority of the Sahaba were young. Young men. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, the Sahaba who were young, he gave them big roles to play in Islam. The first ambassadors of Islam, who was that? Mus'ab ibn Umair. How old was Mus'ab when he was sent to Medina as ambassador for the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام? Bismillah. He was about 17, 18. He was sent from Mecca to Medina to call the people of Medina to Islam so the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام can later on migrate there, right? That's one example. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal رضي الله عنه to Yemen, how old was Mu'adh? 18. As a judge in Yemen. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said about Mu'adh ibn Jabal رضي الله عنه, أعلمكم في الحلال والحرام Mu'adh ibn Jabal. The most knowledgeable amongst you in halal, what's lawful, and haram, what's unlawful, it is Mu'adh ibn Jabal رضي الله عنه. 18. Sent him as a judge to Yemen. طيب. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he made Usama ibn Zayd رضي الله عنه the leader of the army. How old was he? 17. 17. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, after he conquered Mecca, okay, he left a Sahabi known as Asid ibn Atab رضي الله عنه as the governor of Mecca. Okay, after he left Mecca. How old was he? He was 19. To govern the whole city of Mecca. Why? It is because they were qualified. The Prophet ﷺ prepared them for that. It wasn't the age. It was the knowledge that they had. To the extent that in the time of the Abbasi Khilafah, in the Khilafah of Al-Mahdi, the Abbasi Khilafah was based in Iraq, in Baghdad. That was their capital. Okay? Another time, and knowledge has spread. There was a lot of scholars. So all the scholars of Iraq, about 40 of them, they came to the Khalifa. Okay? They came to address the Khalifa. And the man who was leading them, his name was Iyas ibn Muawiyah, rahimahullah. Okay? Iyas ibn Muawiyah, he's leading these 40 scholars, great scholars. Okay, he's their leader, he's their spokesman, speak on their behalf. Okay? Iyas ibn Muawiyah is 20 years old. So when he came and he approached the Khalifa looked at him and he thought, and all these old men, these great scholars, and they send this 20-year-old to address me. So he kind of belittled him. So how did Iyas ibn Muawiyah respond? He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mini. He said, I am older than Usama ibn Zayd when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam made him the governor of Mecca. He said, I am older than Mu'adh ibn Jabal when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam sent him to Yemen. He said, I am older than Abdullah ibn Abbas when he started teaching in the Prophet's message sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I am older than Asid ibn Atab when the Prophet, he said, I am older than, who did I not mention? Usama ibn Zayd, did I mention him? Now, and all those men, he mentioned them all one by one. When the Prophet alayhi sallam, he made them responsible for those different matters. And then when the Khalifa heard this from him, he said, تَقَدَّمْ بَرَكَ اللَّهِ فِيكِ. He said, come forward, may Allah bless you, and let them speak. This is what mattered, because the Prophet ﷺ prepared them, right? And that's why they were great, and they went everywhere in the world, and they spread Islam. And they had lofty aspirations. That all started from the heart. It all started from Tawheed being planted in their heart properly by the Prophet ﷺ. And then them embodying Tawheed in what they said and what they did and everything. Because when we talk about Tawheed and Aqeed and faith, right, it is not something that we just study so that we know that Allah is one and we have to worship Allah, etc., with different types of worship and not to associate partners with Allah and so on. La, it is for us to embody a Tawheed. How do we do that? One of the best ways that the individual, he can embody Tawheed properly and be someone who acts upon Tawheed, it is that this individual, he learns the life of the Prophet ﷺ, because the Prophet ﷺ embodied Tawheed. Right? It's not only learning facts, it's about being a person who embodies Tawheed. Embodies the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Acts upon it. Learn the life of the Prophet ﷺ. طيب. Let's have a look. How was the Prophet ﷺ? Right? We're going to come back to the guys in the cave, but let me really mention this. The Prophet ﷺ, how was he with his family? Who was the Prophet ﷺ sent to as a messenger? Huh? Who was he sent to? Everyone, right? طيب. When he was sent to all of mankind and jinkind, Allah Azza wa Jalla said to him, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. Warn your close kin, your family, start with them. This message, which is for all of mankind, don't start from everyone else. Start from your family first. And that's how the Prophet alayhi sallam, that's where he started. He gathered his uncles, his cousins, etc. And he called them to Islam. Right? Because they have the most rights upon you. Start with them. Okay? And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would later on warn those who follow them. I mean, how close they are to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And then later on, Allah Azza wa Jalla told him to call out to everyone. Right? فَاصْدَعْ بِمَا تُؤْمَرُ. Publicly. طيب. How was the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with his family, his wives? He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. He says, the best of you are those who are the best to their wives, their family. And I'm the best amongst each of their wives and family. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, his wife Khadija, radiallahu anha, his first wife, he never married anyone else with her. Okay? And he loved her the most out of all his wives. Right, Khadija radiallahu anha. How was the Prophet alayhi sallam with Khadija? Even after Khadija died, the Prophet alayhi sallam was loyal to her. And every time the Prophet alayhi sallam would slaughter an animal, okay, he would take some of the meat and he would distribute some of that meat to the friends of Khadija. Every time, imagine. Because he always remembered Khadija. Out of wafa to Khadija radiallahu anha. To the extent that he sallallahu alayhi sallam, he would praise Khadija so much, so that to the extent that otherwise the Prophet alayhi sallam become jealous, like Aisha. Should become jealous. Aisha, she said, Ya Rasulullah, hasn't Allah tabarak wa ta'ala replaced this toothless old woman with something better than her? She means herself. Huh? So the Prophet alayhi sallallahu alayhi sallam, he said, no. She believed in me when no one believed in me. And she supported me and aided me when no one supported me. And he went on and on praising her. And then Aisha, she said, I wish I didn't say that. She got you more jealous. The Prophet alayhi sallam would be in his house. Okay? He'd be in his house. And then someone would knock on the door. And then they ask, who is it? And then the Prophet alayhi sallam would recognize the voice. And he would say, Allahumma hala. Allahumma hala. He said, oh Allah, let it be hala. Hala bint Khuwaylid, the sister of Khadija, because her voice resembled the voice of Khadija. And then he will attend, and then they will sit there for a long period of time talking about Khadija, and then Aisha will become jealous again. Huh? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, did he ever fall out with his wives? Huh? Did they ever fall out, argue, etc.?
Yes,
like any other married couple. They would argue. One time the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, him and Aisha radiallahu anha, they had an argument, disagreement. And Aisha, she raised her voice and she got frustrated, etc. And then, as this is happening in their house, Abu Bakr comes to the house of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So he sees this argument. So then Aisha, she says, okay, let's make Abu Bakr our judge, the judge between us. So she says to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, okay, you tell your side of the story and don't utter accept that which is the truth. So Abu Bakr hears this and he says, has he ever lied? And Abu Bakr is going to beat up Aisha, his daughter. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he stops Abu Bakr and throws him out. And then he says to Aisha, did you see how I protected you from that man? And then she laughs and he completely forgets about the whole argument. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time, Aisha, they had, she got first, she was jealous of one of the other wives of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And then she expressed that to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and she was still upset, and then some of the Sahaba came to the house of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and Aisha was there. And what happened was Aisha, she was she had some dishes, etc. And because she was so angry, she broke the dishes. She smashed them. Okay? And the Sahaba are there, thinking, what's going on here? So then they asked, Ya Rasulullah, what's happening? Before they even asked, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, Gharat ummukum. Said, your mother became jealous. That's it, don't worry. She's okay. Right? Now, so the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, even look, stuff like this, he never made a big doubt it. He tolerated it. Okay? She's a human being. She become jealous. Khalas, let her break her plate. She'll be fine later on. Huh? Now, how was the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with his children? He sallallahu alayhi wasalam, look, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, all of his children, they passed away in his lifetime. He buried every single one of his children except Fatima. He buried them all with his own hands, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine. Yani, if you look at the life of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, you will find that he went through everything that you can imagine. Difficult. And Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us to follow his example, because in his example is the best example in how he dealt with these difficulties. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when he would be sitting with the Sahaba in a gathering, his daughter Fatima would walk in. She was a child at the time. Okay, she'd walk in, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam would see her, he'll get up for her, and he'll go to her, and then he'll kiss her between her forehead, and then he will seat her on his chair between the Sahaba, honoring his daughter. That's how he was with his children, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. How is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with his enemies? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with enemies, when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he conquered Mecca, he entered Mecca with his head lowered, humbled, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then Quraysh, those who were in Mecca, they were afraid. They thought, khalas, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is going to kill us. They said, hadha yawm al-malhama. He's going to massacre us, they thought. But the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, no, hadha yawm al-malhama. It's the day of mercy. Imagine people who persecuted you, insulted you, killed your family, did everything to you. Okay, and you come back and you say to them, today's the day of mercy. Huh? And then he said, I'm not going to say to you except what Yusuf alayhi salam said to the brothers. What is that? لا تثريب عليكم اليوم يغفر الله لكم وهو أرحم الراحمين. That there is no blame upon you today. Allah will forgive you and He is the most merciful. اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. Go, you're all free. They thought, subhanAllah. To the extent that when the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام entered Mecca, okay, who's the leader of Mecca at the time? Huh? Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan was half Muslim. Okay? Not full. So, he still had his doubts. So the Prophet alayhi salam, look at the wisdom of the Prophet alayhi salam. When he entered Mecca, Abu Sufyan is meant to be the leader of Mecca. He feels like he's lost everything, no one respects him, etc. He's lost his reputation and so on. The Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he shows respect and honors him. And he says, Man dakhala dara Abi Sufyan, fahuwa amin. Whoever enters the house of Abu Sufyan, he's safe. يعني indicates Abu Sufyan still has يعني a great status with the Quraysh. Abu Sufyan heard that, he thought, MashaAllah, he respects me. And that encouraged him to embrace Islam properly. Right? This is the wisdom of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. طيب. Even in Quraysh, when the Prophet عليه الصلاة was in Mecca, okay, Mecca, the Quraysh, they were plotting against the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام to stop his da'wah. So they sent one of their men to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And he went to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, Ya Muhammad, if you are insane, sick, we'll bring the best doctors to treat you. If you want money, we'll give you money. If you want women, we'll give you women. If you want authority, we'll make you a leader amongst us. Just stop what you're doing. Tell us what you want. And then he went on and kept saying this nonsense, and the Prophet ﷺ sat there listening to him without interrupting once. And then after he had finished, okay, the Prophet ﷺ, he says to him, after this man basically insulted the Prophet ﷺ basically, the Prophet ﷺ says to him, أَفَرَغْتَ يَا أَبَ الْوَلِيدِ, have you finished, O Abu Walid? He calls him by his kunya, and that's the Arabs, their favorite name to be called by, their kunya. He says, O Abu Walid, have you finished? And he says, yes. So the Prophet ﷺ responds with the Qur'an. He recites Surah Fussilat, حَامِيم, starts the Surah. And then he gets to the ayah, فَإِنْ أَعْرَضُوا فَقُلْ أَنذَرْتُكُمْ صَاعِقَةً مِثْلَ صَاعِقَةِ عَادٍ وَثَمُودٍ. And if they turn away and say to them, oh Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, I have warned you of a punishment, like the punishment of Ad and Thamud. When the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام recited his ayah, Utbah was moved by so much, he placed his hand on the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام's mouth and he said, Hasbuk, stop. And then he left. Now Quraysh are in their parliament and they're waiting for his arrival. They're anticipating his arrival, they're looking out the window to see him come. So they see him from a distance. And they say to each other, لَقَدْ رَجَعَ عُتْبَى بِغَيْرِ الْوَجْهِ الَّذِي ذَهَبَ بِهِ. Utbah has come back with a different face he left with. They can tell something's up. And then he comes back and he says, they say, what's happened? He says, إِنَّ لَهُ لَحَلَاوَ وَإِنَّ عَلَيْهِ لَطَرَاوَ وَإِنَّهُ يَعْلِمْ وَلَا يُعْلَى عَلَيْهِ. He said, it is sweet Quran. And it's eloquent. He was enjoying it, يعني. And he said, and it's going to prevail, nothing will prevail over it. They said, he has done his black magic to you. That's what they said. That's how the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was with his enemies. طيب. How was the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام with those who were considered insignificant in society? For instance, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام would be walking in the streets of Medina, and an old woman, slave woman, she'll see the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and say, Ya Rasulullah, I have a request. And then he saw somebody stops. He tells the Sahaba, go on without me. And he listens to her. And what does this woman, what does she do? She tells the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام her whole life story. He doesn't say, yalla, get to the point, I don't have time. La la la, he listens to her. He doesn't interrupt her once. And then when she finishes, he says to her, okay, here I am. Take me to any of the streets of Medina you wish to help you with what you need. So she says, okay. She takes him to the market to help her with shopping. And then she takes him to her master, and so on. Takes him around the whole city. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام doesn't say, I'm too busy for you. Even though he was extremely busy. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام used to have a woman who used to clean the masjid of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Cleaner. What happened? One day the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام came to the masjid, he didn't find her. He asked the Sahaba, where is she? Look, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was aware of everyone in Medina. Imagine, he's responsible for everyone, he's aware of every single person. The cleaner of the masjid, he knows, he's aware of her. He asked, where is she? The Sahaba, they said, she passed away, Ya Rasulullah, and we buried her. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, why didn't you tell me? He got angry. And he said, دُلُّونِي عَلَىٰ قُبِّهَا, show me her grave. And then they showed him her grave, and he went to her grave, and he prayed janaz on her. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one was insignificant to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Everyone mattered. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام would be walking in the streets of Medina, and he would see a young boy. Okay? He was the half-brother of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. So this young boy was very upset, he saw him, crying. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he saw him and said, he sat with him, said to him, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام knew that this young boy had a sparrow, a bird that he used to play with. So he said to him, Ya Aba Umayr, according by his kunya, his favorite name, Ma fa'ala Nughayr, what happened to your sparrow? He said, Mat ya Rasulullah, died a messenger of Allah. So the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام sat with him and comforted him until he completely forgot about the bird. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب الصحابة الرفيع عليه الصلاة والسلام he was with the Sahaba knows we can say this given this is the great character of Rafi alayhi salatu wasalam. Where did this all come from? This is Tawheed. This is embodying Tawheed. Because you make your decisions based on does this please Allah or does this anger Allah? That's Tawheed. That's you embodying Tawheed. Every decision you make, every statement you utter, you think about, is it going to please Allah or anger Allah? That is you embodying Tawheed. It's you acting upon Tawheed. And that's what the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام did. And that's why he had the best character. And that's why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, أكثر ما يدخل الناس الجنة تقوى الله حسن الخلق. The most matter that admits people into paradise, it is God consciousness and good character. Because God consciousness, what is in the heart, it is what leads you to having good character. Because you make your decisions based on the pleasure of Allah. Ibadah. And that will make everything that you do an act of worship. Everything that you do, an act of worship. Right? So that's why Tawheed, it is something that we need to learn to embody. Iman, embody it. You know, everything that we say. Because Iman is in the heart, and it's statements on the tongue, and it's action on the lips. The more good you do, it increases and it becomes stronger. The more evil you do, it decreases and it becomes weaker. Now. So these young men, okay, they did that. They embodied Tawheed. And their whole mission was a mission of Tawheed. To protect the Tawheed of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. So they sacrificed their lives. And they sacrificed everything, their livelihood, everything for Tawheed. 309 years they spent in a cave, sleeping. All their life gone. Huh? Why? For Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Because nothing is more important than the religion of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. That's how you make decisions, based on Allah. And when you do that, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will protect you from fitan, from trials. Especially where we live, right? The society that we live in, it is a society that we surround with so much fitan regarding deen, okay, misconceptions that are put out there regarding our belief, fitan that are to do with shahwa, desires, because trials, they stem from two matters, either shubha, doubts and misconceptions, or shahwa, desires. That's where all evil comes from. It's either that you have doubts and that leads you to do evil, or either that you have a certain desire and that desire leads you astray. Okay? So that is what you have to control. You know what the greatest way that individual can control that? What do you think? Huh? You know one of the greatest ways that you can control yourself from shahwa? Lowering grades is one way, yes?
Fasting.
Sorry?
Fasting.
Fasting, you know what he does? Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ista'inu bis sabri wa salah. Oh, you who believe, seek assistance in patience and prayer. The ulama, they say that patience here, it is fasting. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Verily those who have patience, they'll be granted their reward without any account. Okay, the patient here is those who fast. Because fasting, in order to fast properly, you have to have patience. And it teaches you patience. Okay? And patience, it is what restrains you from doing things that Allah Azza wa Jalla is not pleasing. What's the definition of patience? It is to restrain the nafs from, or to restrain the nafs within everything, or within what it dislikes, in order to attain the pleasure of Allah. To restrain the nafs, the soul, within what it dislikes, to attain the pleasure of Allah. That's patience. Okay? The soul naturally doesn't like to do a lot of worship. It doesn't like that. It's inclined to just have fun and do crazy things at night. Yeah? That's what the nafs likes. Huh? But when Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala tells you to have patience, it is to restrain it within what it dislikes. So the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام says in hadith, حُفَّتِ الْجَنَّةِ بِالْمَكَارِ وَحُفَّتِ النَّارِ بِالشَّهَوَاتِ. That Jannah has been surrounded with what the soul dislikes. And the hellfire has been surrounded with what the soul desires. So in order to attain Jannah, you have to restrain the nafs within what you dislike. So attain Jannah. Right? So fasting teaches you that. Fasting will help you control your desires. On top of that, when you are fasting, you worship Allah Ta'ala more. But to increase your iman. And that protects you from shubuhat, misconceptions. Okay? And another way to combat misconceptions, it is through knowledge. The more you learn, okay, then it will protect your faith. And that is what iman is. Iman is based on knowledge. The more you know, the more iman you have. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla, in numerous places in the Quran, He mentions knowledge before iman. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ وَالْإِيمَانِ لَقَدْ لَبِثْتُمْ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ الْبَعْثِ Allah says, those who possess knowledge and iman. Allah mentioned knowledge before iman, indicating that in order to have proper iman, you require knowledge. And Allah says, وَكَذَلِكَ أُوحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِّنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ Allah says, like that we reveal to you a spirit from our command. مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ You didn't know the scripture or iman of Muhammad alayhi sallam. Allah mentioned the scripture before iman, knowledge, يعني, before iman, indicating that in order to have proper iman, you require knowledge. Learn about Allah. Huh? Not to help you safeguard your deen. Knowledge will help you safeguard your deen from fitan and trials. And as-sabr ala ta'ati Allah, patience upon the obedience of Allah. That's one type of patience. And as-sabr an ma'asi Allah, patience upon in refraining from disobedience of Allah. And as-sabr ala aqdari Allah al-mu'lima, and patience upon the painful decree of Allah. These are three types of patience. With that, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, when you attach to Him and you learn about Allah and you learn the religion of Allah and you act upon it, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will grant you your own cave. You live in your own cave, wherever you are, safeguarding you from fitan, because it is deen that protects you. So we ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us from those who are protected from fitan trials. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us from those who hear the speech and follow the best of it. And we ask Allah Jalla fi'ula to make us from the righteous servants. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to forgive our sins. And we ask Allah Jalla fi'ula to make us from those who are guided and are increased in guidance, and to make us from those who are God conscious. Innahu waliyu dhalika wal qadir alayhi wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakumullah khair. Fi majal al as'ila ya Abdul Hadi. Any questions? Because generally, when people don't have questions, I always have questions. Ah, mashallah. Now you have questions.
How did Ashab al-Kahf know that there is just one God?
Allah Azza wa Jalla inspired them. It's ilham from Allah. As Imam Sa'di alayhi rahmatullah, he says, Alhamahum Allah tabarak wa ta'ala wa waffaqahum li ibadatihi wa ta'atihi. Now, it's ilham, inspiration from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. You know, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He can inspire you certain things in your heart. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, He mentions that in the Quran. For instance, the mother of Musa alayhi salam, is the mother of Musa a prophet? Huh? Is she a prophet? She's not, right? But then Allah says in the Quran, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضِعِيهِ We revealed to the mother of Musa to breastfeed him. Allah says she received revelation. What does wahi mean? It means al-ilham, inspiration. Allah inspired her. Okay? So Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will inspire His servants, and He will grant them tawfiq to do certain things, right? And this is from Allah Jalla fi'ala. So that's what happened. Now, and as soon as that they felt that in their heart, they acted upon it, and that's where the test was. Allah Azza wa Jalla creates us with fitrah naturally, but on top of that, when Allah inspires you to believe in something, okay, now where you're being tested is to act upon that, and that's where the test was, and they passed that test. Now, yes.
There's also a historical perspective concerning this, that they came after the time of Isa alayhi salam, so they had that kind of teaching and stuff, but the place they lived in, it was very corrupted, like, so the religion has been corrupted, but there was something that was present there that they knew from the religion of Isa alayhi salam.
La shak. What happened was every nation, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sent a messenger to them. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sent a messenger that tells them about tawheed and to worship Allah alone. But what happened? The people would corrupt that and they would distort that. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla would send messengers again and prophets to rectify that. Allah Azza Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُبَّةِ الرَّسُولَ أَنَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. We have said, certainly, we have sent to every nation a messenger. Why? To worship Allah, to abstain and to refrain from ta'ud, worshiping other than Allah. Every nation, a messenger was sent to them, warning them. Allah says, وَإِلَىٰ عَادٍ أَخَاهُمْ هُودًا قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ وَإِلَىٰ ثَمُودَ أَخَاهُمْ صَالِحًا قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ وَإِلَىٰ مَدْيَنَ أَخَاهُمْ شُعَيْبًا قال يا قوم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره. Allah says to Ad, we sent their brother Hud. What did he say? Oh my people, worship Allah. There's no other deity worthy of worship except Him. To Thamud, we sent their brother Salih. He said, oh my people, worship Allah. There's no deity worthy of worship except Allah. To Madian, we sent their brother Shu'ayb. He said, oh my people, worship Allah. There's no deity worthy of worship except Him. That's the call of all the messengers. So every nation, a messenger was sent to them. But the people corrupted it. As the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says that after Adam alayhi salam, everyone was upon Tawheed, worshipping Allah alone. Okay? And he mentions a number, I can't remember, I'm becoming old. I can't remember the exact number. He mentions how many, the exact years, but I don't recall that every people were upon Tawheed. And then what happened? People distorted it. They started worshipping other than Allah, and then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala sent the first messenger who was Nuh alayhi salam. Right? So the time between Nuh and Adam, majority of people, for all those years, they were upon Tawheed. So people distorted it. And how did they do that? The Prophet alayhi salam tells us, what happened was that the people were righteous amongst them. Okay? And Allah mentions their names in the Quran. These righteous men, okay? The generation that came after Shaitan, he came to them, he said, you know, why don't you make idols and pictures of these righteous people so that when you see them, this will encourage you to do ibadah, to worship Allah. That's what he said to them. So they did that. They said, that's a good idea. It motivates us to do good. So they did that. And then the next generation came, and he said, and then Shaitan said to them, your forefathers, they used to worship these idols. So worship them. And slowly, they started worshipping and the shirk spread. Now. And then that's what Shaitan convinces you, that in order to get closer to Allah, you must have someone in between you and Allah to get to Allah. And that's what they all believe. Just like Quraysh believed. They said, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We don't worship these idols except for them to draw us closer to Allah. We know there's one creator, but we're not worthy enough to directly address Allah. So we need to go through these idols. That's what they believe. And their idols as well, لَا تُعُزَّهُ, but they're righteous men. Well, they made idols and start to worship. The same thing, it just repeats itself. Now, any other questions? No.
Is there like any specific significance to 309 years? Like why not 100 or 200?
Because Allah Azza wa Jalla decreed it to be 309 years.
Oh,
okay. Huh? Khalas? Final question. Okay, many.
Well, after you, sir.
Tafadhal.
You know the first prank that you mentioned?
MashaAllah. That tells me that you are amongst those who were doing the crazy thing last night. Because that's all you took away from the lecture, MashaAllah.
But you mentioned about, you know, our pranks or whatever joke we make, it has to be within the Sharia.
Na'am. Can't joke
with. So, you know, the Sahaba mentioned that Sahaba is a slave.
Na'am, slave of Allah.
Ah,
he's a slave. He never liked. That was paid back. The money was given back to them. So we have their mic, no one was impressed.